We want plenty of Ben's guitar.
Well, tune up, and we'll have Ben accompany my brother Silver. No, I just can't get it tonight. I don't think I can do that stunt tonight. But I used to do. Eric will remember this. I don't know about you. But I used to go in the huts and do a little song. Well, as you can understand, with no instruments. And of course, singing on your own, it's a bit difficult to appreciate.
Yeah.
So what I used to do is get an old broomstick, you know, and start off with Drops of Kettle Whistle. Ding, 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 ding. Then a bit of comic act, you know, pretend to push my finger over. And then strike off in a song, see? And it seemed to go down all right. Well,
Captain Morgan. No, but I was a Sergeant Major.
Let me assure you, it didn't count for much in the
first game. I remember when we went in there, through in 59, that early cold bloody morning. Were you with it then? That cold bloody morning, wasn't you?
No, they were already there because we came in February, wasn't it?
Have you heard about the Gentry Johnson fight? Where the black buck nigger fought the white? You can bring all the hammers with you got, and you fight the whole damn lot. He jumped off the bell in the belfry, and he wants to find Jack Dempsey. That's my brother. Silvest, what has he got? He got a row of 40 medals on his chest. Big chest! He killed 40 niggers in the west. He takes no rest. Bigger man, hell to fire. Son of a gun, don't push, just show. Plenty of room for you and me. He's got an arm like a leg, lady's leg, and a punch that'll sink a battleship. Big ship. He deems all the army and the navy to put the wind up. Sylvester. Now we thought he'd take a trip to Italy. He thought he'd take a trip by the sea. So he jumped off the harbour in New York, and he swam like a man made of cork. He saw the Louisiana in distress. What did he do? He swallowed all the water in the sea. Big swallow. And put the Louisiana on his chest, and took the whole bloody lot to Italy. That's my brother Sylvester. What has he got? He got a row of 40 medals on his chest. Big chest. He killed 40 niggers in the west. He takes no rest. Bigger the man, hellfire, son of a gun. Don't push, just show. Plenty of room for you and me. He's got an arm like a leg, lady's leg, and a punch that will sink a battleship. Big ship. It takes all the army and the navy to put the wind up. Sylvester.
Yeah, 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 yeah. That's cracking.
That was slow, me.
Where did you see Sylvester?
Oh,
right, all over. That wasn't particularly connected with Italy, was it? That one?
No.
You ever seen that on the ship before you got there?
No.
There wasn't a lot of people who knew it though, really, was there?
No, if you understand it, a lot of these songs were individual, weren't they?
They weren't sung in concert,
as it were, you know, throughout the camp. They were sung by odd people at odd times, you know.
Yeah.
But slowly
they didn't get together like and form a glee party and sing these songs.
And did other people just
run, jump, fuck, suck, roll a barrel over?
No.
a lot of these songs were done by individuals, but a lot of other people picked them up from
that
one person
there. And sang them round and around.
Probably in the hot road.
That's the
really great wheel.
The great wheel.
I
don't want to make any mistake.
We didn't. Let's have Salome. Why not let's have Salome, then the bloody great wheel really is.
Isn't deep in this.
You just listen to somebody.
We probably all knew them. But they were sung at odd times. Mm-hmm.
Salome, Salome, that's my girl, Salome. So she drank all the beer from the boozer down the street. There was my brother Jim, fair fucked up, down in the cellar with the old bob pop, standing there with the thing all bare, waiting for someone to slide it there, to slide it. And glide it right up her fucking chute. She's an old black cow, twice the size of me. Hairs on the cup like the branches of a tree. She can come and just put sucker on the barrel or a truck, and that's my girl, so low me. Jesus wants me for a sunbeam, and the fucking the sunbeam are mine.
That is Salome.
Salome disposed of.
Do you know any more of
Salome
it?
What? Salome disposed of.
Do you know any more of Salome? Right.
Black, take this out.
On Monday, she takes you to his dreads. On Tuesday night, she fucks like hell, isn't it? Saturday night, she has a spell. Sunday night, she fucks like hell. On Monday, she takes between her toes, then between her fingers, down between her toes.
Then it goes on.
For the days of the week?
Yeah,
for
the days of the week.
What about when you're in the room?
Oh,
yes, come on. Ben's the Rangarangaroo man. Right,
you're not deep in it, are you?
Yeah,
we're all
good,
then.
We're all
good. Go on, let's try it. Let's have a quick check back, because we don't want to make that terrible mistake we made last week.
That's what you call a Rangarangaroo.
Yes, that's it. Right, Ben? Ben knows this one. Right.
You're going into Rangarangaroo.
Right.
Now as I was walking out one day, I met a sweet girl on my way. I said, hello, how do you do? She said, you'd like to play with my ringarangaroo. Your ringarangaroo? I said, what's that? She said, it's soft like a pussy cat, with hair all round and cut in two. That's what I call my ringarangaroo. She took me to her father's cellar. She said, you are a nice young fella. She gave me wine and whiskey too, and I played around with the ringarangaroo. Just then her dad, he came and said, I'm afraid you've lost your maiden head. So take a trip now and your luggage too, and go and live on your ringarangaroo. She went to town.
Hold it.
That's all right. Carry on rolling then, so we go back. Carry on.
She went to town, set up house and hall. She hung this sign outside her door. $5 down, no less will do, when you come to play with my ringarangaroo. The fellas came, the fellas went. The price dropped down to 5 cents, from sweet 16 to 92. They played around with the ringarangaroo. Now a ringarangaroo is sadly worn. A ringarangaroo is badly torn. Let's say goodbye now, bid a fond adieu. Let's say goodbye to a ringarangaroo.
That's a good one. Yeah. We better do Tugs before, because Tug's got to go at night, and we make sure we get that one. The Scouse song.
Tug's really?
On nights, is Tug? Are you on nights? We're getting the coffee now, or we'll get bread and currants in.
What's that?
What's that? That's a joke, sir.
Oh, the Wanderers' War, wasn't it? That was one, wasn't it?
Which one was one, Frank, as Tug's hand? I thought you said it was the Scouse song.
Yeah, it was a Scousey. It was a chap from Wisbech, Sprat Thomas.
Sprat Thomas,
aye.
What was it you sang it the other night?
I'm riding along on a bright way.
What's the one?
Bound for nobody knows where. I'm run away from home just this morning, and my heart is heavy inside. I quarrel with my poor old father because of the things I had done. He called me a drunkard, a gambler, not fit to be called his son. I swore and I cursed my father. I told him his words were a lie. I packed up my clothes in a bundle and went to wish mother goodbye. My poor mother, she broke down and cried, and around me her arms she did fling, saying, oh son, please don't leave me, it's more than my poor heart can stand. So boys, hear the wanderer's warning, don't break your poor mother's heart. Stay by her side, cause she needs you, and let nothing drive you apart.
That's a smashing one. Eh?
That's lovely, isn't it?
Who's that? Who sang that? Turk of Blood from Wisbech?
Yes, Sprat Thomas.
Uh-huh. Was that one they sing round the billets at night?
When you were quiet.
Yeah.
As I say, the order you started to sing a bit of it, so
Was that every night?
Well, most nights.
That's done most nights, yes. Yeah, the same song that told a story or give an account of an amusing incident or some real incident in the life.
Was that sort of after lights out or after dusk?
No, it was in the toward getting on for lights out, you know, the last hour.
Yeah.
Very often, though, we used to walk around the huts, hadn't we, for exercise.
Yeah. At night time?
Mm. Yes. You'd split yourselves up into parties, like two or three together, and you'd march down the huts, either recounting an experience or amusing incident, or you'd be making future plans, you know,
you see,
that never came up.
Some parts,
well, deliberately.
Oh yes.
What
yes.
Do you mean? You just make them up?
You'd say like, well, when I get back home, I'm going to start a business, you know, and you elaborate on what you're going to do. Say. Mobile fish and chip shop, that was one of Pompey's ideas. And Tubby Hills, remember Tubby Hills?
Yeah.
And incidentally, I've got fascinated with the way they were talking about it, that it never came off. Of course, it's a different thing. Although this Pompey did go into the antique business, but failed.
Did they know when they were talking about it, it wasn't going to come off? I mean, were they
doing no, you were really, planning this thing,
well,
you know, in your mind. You were going to do all these things. Oh my God!
Like, keep your mind active in one thing, because you see, you didn't know whether you were ever going to get away from there, ever get home.
Correct.
You never knew that.
Oh, I think
you never knew whether you were going to get home, so you've got to make these suggestions amongst yourselves.
Keep yourself that you were.
Keep yourself your mind from going totally blank.
There was time for anything you'd never come up.
Well, I was just going to say, I think you'll all agree with me that you had that innate fear that you would something would happen to you. You'd never get back home.
Yeah.
Especially in Germany.
All this news coming along.
And when you went to the baths in Germany.
When
we went to the baths in Germany. You remember the disinfectors? Infestors? Infestors. You went in a big den, there was a Russian bloke in there with a big moustache. Do you remember? Did you ever see him?
And he got the spray, the pump.
No, we went into a place where there was old pipes.
Yeah.
With holes in.
Yeah.
Well, we'd heard about these ovens, you see. With the,
yeah.
The room
you heard about the ovens?
Oh, yeah, we'd heard about the ovens. We were quite near to Balson at one time, you know.
Really? You knew about all that? Did you?
Well, we did all these tales about it.
Yeah.
And you never knew.
I know exactly what he'd done.
Nick, it's all about, eh?
They used to strip us off, and then you have to go through the barbers, you see, and off came your hair, and they shaved all around your old man, you see. And as you walk through towards the showers, I always remember there's a Frenchman sitting there, cross-legged with a bookie between his
legs. Ah, that's it.
And he's got a brush, and he dips his
head,
and it's obviously Lysol or some powerful disinfectant, you see. And as you walk past, he goes, oink, oink. and in broken French, he says, look out for the prick and the balls.
this was the Russian as did
us. For some reason. You've been shaved. I mean, you put up to shave on. Well, you had a shave. And that's only,
it's meant to do you good.
You, you put carbolic on. My God. I'll never forget, in Greece, the man sits down, but just, you left all your gear, he was going to be deloused. So their system of delousing was, you just got all your clobber and bundled it up in your coat, you see, and chucked it in this boiler. It wasn't a boiler, it was a steam big tank.
Yes.
And there you got to march down to the beach then, and you were going to be spraying like. So all you got on was your daisy roots. You got your shoes on, you see. Down there you went, and you had one of our buds, and you got what you spray the trees with, you know. And you got it strapped on his back, and he sprayed you all over. By God, it didn't have to give you some sting, you know. Carbolic stuff, you know.
But you say that you knew about the gas ovens. You'd heard about that.
Oh, we
because, I mean, they told them a similar tale. They didn't tell them. They thought they were going to be disinfested, didn't they? The Jews, when they went in these ovens.
Oh, yes.
And they switched the poison gas on, didn't they?
But we'd heard these tales long before. I'm sure you must have heard some of them.
Yeah.
And we were all, I think that we had the innermost fear. We never talked about it. No one would ever say to you about that. I'm frightened that we can get done in today, like when we. But you always had that, I think everybody had that fear when you went into this. Sorry.
More so in the big camp.
Same as Muhlberg. Where you went into a
where we went place. After.
Well,
and everywhere was sealed up, you know.
Working parties.
And then they turned on the warm water, and then they turned on cold water.
Then you went in that room for dry off.
Kind of thing.
No towels.
No towel.
Did this always happen when you went to a new camp?
Mm.
Oh yes.
And you'd be surprised what lice will stand up to. Now then, I tell you, they put in these things, you see, in these tanks, and all the steam's put in, and then you've been deloused to the old spray, you've had a spray on, and now you come back to get your gear. Of course, you slung it out, and then there you were, sorted it all out, like, who's it was and who's it wasn't. You could open it up, and the lice would still be crawling. After going through the steaming.
What we used to do,
used to paint the steam. And crematoriums and gas ovens and all that, but you might like to know about one competition.
Who got the most louse on
it? One competition we had in our camp, it was in the camp south of Mullin, and of course we were fed on mainly potato stew. Well, potato stew, as you may or may not know, produces a vast amount of gas. So that when the barracks were shut up at night, and they were shut and bolted, there was some rather highly orchestral sound. And one bloke, incidentally, he was a BSc, who was very scientific, so everything he said in that line was regarded as gospel. He said, did you know it's highly inflammable? So that sort of set the ball rolling. One bloke had got a box of matches. and they were shouting across the barrack room, I can feel one coming, they dash over the lighted match, and you'd see a blue flash of football.
Quite true.
Right, like?
Yes, that's gospel.
And that went on for about an hour, and it caused so much hilarity, they turned the guard out, they thought,
I've seen that to myself, I wouldn't believe it.
You know, they said it will ignite. They said, never in this wide world. They said it will. And at that time, I was wearing John L. Sullivan, the old long pants, you know, with that gold, very cold spell of weather. And so, this friend of mine, I said, hey, up, there's one about, righto. So he has to try some, I said, put it down.
Is it full light?
And you can feel the heat.
Which is it?
You feel the heat of it.
Oh, I'll come down. That hot
gold. Yeah, I'll come down though, I'll come down.
I've heard of that, I've never seen it, but I've heard it.
Oh, it's
hilarious.
Yes, I've seen that,
but
I wouldn't believe it.
This hadn't done harm, God, and nothing famous, and it's only gone to find out what the hell was going on.
They did it on me,
and
I tell you, I was wearing John L. Sullivan's at the time, and of course, the gas would be trapped. Yeah. So all the heat went all around my arse.
It
spreads.
Now,
They used to have competitions. A friend of mine who was in an Italian camp used to line up and the one who could make the biggest flame won himself a fag or something.
Everybody thinks that prisoner of war life was all gloom and despair.
And
sheer desperation, I think we used to swing to the other extreme, doing crazy things.
I think the British in prisoner of war, though, enjoy themselves more. I don't know, I use the word very loosely, enjoyed.
Yes.
Than any other country. I mean, more than, say, the Dutch, the Hollanders, or the Frenchmans. The Aussies didn't do too much. But the Americans used to slump around.
Proper despondent, weren't they?
Oh, they always just say, pity me, I'm a prisoner. That was the attitude, I think. They wouldn't lace the shoes up, they'd tread the tops down and slump around like that, dirty, unkempt and that.
I've never seen anything quite so incredible, because...
Really, the Americans...
One minute they're 20 quid a week flyers, used to the best of everything, heated barracks and the best food and all that. And a few hours later, they're in a prison camp. They've been shot down. And they sort of fold up like a punctured balloon.
Yeah, they do.
And I've never seen anything deteriorate so quick in my life.
Yeah.
They just went
they
like...
They can't take it.
They're like hobos.
What about Sula Bay? What about Sula Bay?
That's one of yours, isn't it, Sula Bay? Well, the others know some of it, don't they? It's an old song going back to the Anzac landing, isn't it?
Dardanelle.
That's a First World War song, isn't it?
Yeah.
But it was very popular because it was one of these maudlin things that you sang when you're feeling sorry for yourself.
And then we're having the
Australian
brothers. We've got quite a lot of Australian in us, haven't we?
Yes.
Oh, it's naughty song.
You're going to lead off then. Don't worry, I mean,
we're all right, Tom? In an old Australian cottage, with the roses round the door, stood a young Australian lassie, with a letter from the war, and with her mother's arms around her, she gave way to bitter sighs. As she read this sad, sad letter, sure the tears fell from her eyes. Why do I weep? Why do I pray? My love's asleep, so far away. He played his part that August day, but left my heart in Suda Bay. So she joined a band of sisters beneath a cross of red, trying to forget her heartache and her lover who was dead. So when another came to woo her, he so sadly went away. When he heard the sad, sad story of that grave in Suda Bay, why do I weep? Why do I pray? My love's asleep so far away.
he played his part that August day, but left my heart in Souter Bay.
Audience, please.
Very well. I've got a little tippy that goes with that tune, and it's all about a pisshole and a ladder by the door.
What was that? The tune of that one?
That's the tune of that one.
Oh, let's have a listen to that. Oh, that's the one you were singing the other day, wasn't it?
That's the shorty. No, I didn't sing that one. This is the other one.
Yeah. It was in an Austrian lager.
That's right, with a pistol by the door.
Oh yeah, let's hear that. How irreverent.
We've been in arsehole.
It's the only one.
Sam, this drinking tip in it.
Well, they were in 59.
I don't think by the door.
Aye.
It was in an Austrian lager with a pistol by the door. The gefandry stood waiting for the finish of the war. When the flies all buzzing round him, he gave waves of horrid moans and cursed the bleeding Führer. May the devil get his bones. Why do we work and toil all day when we could sleep so far away? We played our part, forgot to run, and we got caught by a bleeding Hun.
Did you know that one, Ted?
No,
this is one of the lads that made up in the camp.
No,
it's Pavlin again. No. This other one, the longer one.
Oh, let's have that one. This is a smash.
Now, this is all about, you'll get the gist of this right away, for simple reasons, about getting up in the morning, and you'll get the words, you see, because it's bad. Yeah.
Can I just ask you, that thing about we've counted the lights, was that the chorus? Or was there a chorus, or did he sing straight through it?
No, he just sang straight through it.
Anyway, let's hear it. It's a smasher, this one. This is... Who's the author of this one? Here?
It's Prisoner of War. It's Dick Pavlin.
How do you spell that?
Pavlin.
Pavlin.
You come from Norfolk way. Grandchild. The parson says, "How stay and put on your clothes. You must go to abide, as everyone knows. So fold up your blankets and put them in line. When I blow the whistle, just get out on time. The prisoners all wake up and shout out, 'Get stuffed!' Of this blinking sleeping, we've not had enough. So down in your fleet pits and stay there till time. For 16 hours abide is a mighty long time. 20 minutes has gone, boys, the first whistle blows. We all get and scramble and drag on our clothes. 5 minutes to go, chap, just give him a go. Don't blow the last whistle, for goodness sake, Joe. 3.5 years have gone, boys, our spirit's still good. Sometimes it's all hoeing or just chopping wood. They can't get us down, boys, to them it's quite plain. Just given the time, we would do it again. We've counted the days and we've counted the nights. We've counted the minutes, we've counted the lights. We've counted the footsteps, we've counted the stars. We've counted a million of these prison bars. We've just heard the sirens, our spirits are up. We hope to see action to lighten things up. But nothing happens, nothing we know.
It just brings back memories of long, long ago. Oh, go beg the parson with your payroll to buy some flea powder for this lousy old. It flies in the daytime, it flees all the night. My poor arms are aching from scratching the bite. There's just come a letter, heart in despair. Our packets are out of, we don't know just where. Take care of your conserve, you'll have to make spare. You can't keep on working and living on air. Come on, you gefangeners, with hearts brave and true. Don't trust your old bower, whatever you do. Don't trust your old bower, no matter how kind. You do all his abide, then he'll get your behind. You get that because it's all about the getting on scheme. And I tell you what we used to, tell you what we did one time. As I say, they could never get the English bond down, and as you were saying, they'd try anything like that. Now then, there come a issue around that you wasn't supposed to have any German guild, any money.
Right.
You could have the lager, of course, yes, which was. Yes. Now then, so one of our chaps had got one of these, you could put a cap in a little bomb for yourself and your children and drop it in a little bang. Well, he got a 5-mark piece, but you could spring load it at the back. It was one of these trick things you'd find. And you could put a cap in it, you see. Well, one of these bods got it off one of the chests from the farm, you know. This German was drumming it in and like, you must not have any German money and this, that, and the other. Well, what he used to do, he used to take the lamp out at night, you see, and then lock the door, and that was it. Now, first thing in the morning, he used to come and put the lock in. So, he loaded this one and put it on the table. Un certain Simon qui se fait appeler fils de la toile affirme être le Messie qui doit délivrer la terre sainte du joug et de l'esclavage.
What did he do?
He didn't know. I was going to know more about it. Oh, he went mad. Oh, well, when he put it up, everybody was waiting for it, Everybody was waiting for it.
Did he put the light in and then he'd wait? Did he put it onto your rations or something? Maybe?
But you had every train on the job. Now, another thing was, sometimes, you see, lock you up. And after they've mastered switching and taking the lamps out, they used to have a switch on the outside. So it was when he said, right, oh, that's it, like, good enough, and then locked you to, and out the light you go. Well, we had Miss Mary, he was very good at using motor mechanics, so he could do all the same. So he used to get up to the switch box. And put a safety pin, anything like that, across it, and off we did our carding again, And another thing he did, he got a small, it had a small transformer and it reduced it to 6 volts. And he used to have it for reading, you see. And now he did, not like shop wire to do it, because the jelly goes, he didn't want the jelly seed. So what he did, he just went down with his knife, down the wall like this, with two cuts like that, and sort of sprung this in tight. And that was another thing he used to do away. And one day we were doing the lager, washing it and this and that. Of course, they were alive. And of course, I didn't run down and say, we were getting it, And I've often wondered since, because we left that just as it was in this place. So whoever had it to be done, and they didn't run down
I was telling them about the wirelesses that were made.
Yeah.
And really, if you take them to the average layman, he wouldn't believe you.
They never found them. They never found them. They never found them.
How they made them, I'll never know, because we couldn't get valves then.
And the snag was,
I don't know how the hell they made them. Got them.
They get a whisper, you see. They get a whisper that there was a wireless in this camp. This took place in most of the big camps.
Yes.
Now then, they get a whisper, and all of a sudden they'd say, right, oh, there's a big search on. But they never found them.
Never found. I don't think they ever found one, did they?
No.
Now, we had one hidden in 59, if you remember, and it was under a stool, an ordinary stool, and it was underneath the seat of the stool. And that's where it's kept. None of us, I never knew this till after myself. There was only about three people who ever knew where it was, or who operated it, because the policy was, if you didn't know, they couldn't get it out of you. See, so if they took any one of us and tortured it, more or less, which we were always afraid of, but they never did, mind you, we couldn't divulge the secret of it because we didn't know. Simple as that.
Well, I do know where one was in our camp, because when they found...
Well, probably one odd ones knew.
Well, there were three in our camp, but it was a big camp. There was 1,100 men in the camp, but we caused that much trouble. They broke us up into small working parties. And there were three in that camp, but I do know where one was, because as we were going, now I said there was 1,100 men, we got things organised. We got three dance bands, we got a brass band, a mouth organ band, and we got a male voice choir, debating society, and we worked a 3-day week. You can believe that.
You've got a good union.
It was trade unionism at its best. We'd been prisoners for 2.5 years, and we'd got guards that were old men and young boys. And
they
sick had men.
To them,
yeah. Without trying to brag, well, everybody says that we bragged, but I can come to that later, but we quite honestly got them where we wanted them, within reason.
Yeah.
And in the summertime, the lads were escaping at the rate of 4 a day. How many got back? Very, very few. It was probably 3, I think, that I know of, certainly. But they were escaping at the rate of 4 a day when they got fed up. They just disappeared over the horizon.
Do you remember that chap who used to escape
radio?
One I was trying to think of.
Spoke fluent Italian.
Mm.
One of the radios was built into the side drum of the dance band's
factory. But they never got very far, does it, Ernest?
That was the trouble. Escaping wasn't the big problem, actually.
It was organised.
When you got outside.
Right.
I think many of us could have escaped,
yes,
but we'd no idea when we got outside. We realised this, so we didn't do it.
Oh, we were getting...
Now, he spoke fluent Italian, but he always got caught.
The last time I remember... 20 miley to Switzerland back.
He got caught on a tram.
Straight opposite there.
On the tram? Travelling one
of the... Turn right.
But the snag was, he always used to take somebody with him. And that somebody used to give him away.
What an idiot.
Purposely. But... Of course, he couldn't speak like Taffy. Taffy could speak fluent Italian.
But the last time he was caught, in 59...
The last time he was caught?
He went out as a soldier, didn't he?
Aye, he walked through the gate and dressed as a soldier.
What's his name, fella? He was a commando, though, wasn't he?
What, dressed as an Italian soldier?
Yeah, because we got an Italian uniform, see?
Aye, he was a commando, he was.
And he made a rifle and bayonet up out of the old empty tins.
There's no problem in getting out of the camp, the working camp.
Well, he was always brought
back. How many times did he escape then?
Four or five times, but
I would say at least five times.
At least 5 times. Yeah.
Those are the best definitions.
And they said that our camp was impregnable. You couldn't escape.
They bought the camp.
Yeah, there was 3 tunnels.
Oh, I bought the camp.
I've got to order my book. Hey, we've got to get through this list of songs, haven't we?
What's the next one?
Pop bank song.
Oh, we'll leave that till Jeff comes, because Jeff Barton's coming with his guitar.
Oh,
what about your Laverari song, then,
Frank?
Have you been giving it some thought, you two men?
Sempre Laverari, bunker bunker here, if you marry,
lazy pensioner, and gives the stare a starry queen, we're all browned off, as you can see.
Have you gone to near the lamplight, fell down with that proper song?
Go and do it again, Frank. The two. Yes,
right.
Go on.
I've got
my
singing
voice. I don't think we got the first bit very clear.
Sempre la Ferrari, poca mongeria. Sempre fumari, inglesi prigionier. Antis de stere, starry queen. We're all browned off, as you can see.
Is it Lily of the Lamplight, isn't it?
You finished it off?
Well, sempre lamorari is always working.
Yeah.
Sempre fumari
is always smoking.
Polka mangiare is little food.
Sempre lavorare con polka
mangiare.
Sempre fumare, always smoking.
What does that last bit mean? English prisoners.
Starry Quay is why.
Oh well, that's, you've remembered it all this time. Oh, that's great. What?
Frank's watching Chainsaw.
Oh yeah, come on, Frank. The watching Chainsaw.
that's the one.
Right, come on, Frank.
As I was out walking one morning in May, I met a fair maiden so charming and gay. I said, pretty maiden, may I walk with you? She gave her consent, so I walked with her too. We walked and we walked till we came to a brook. I said, pretty maiden, may I have a swim? I swam and I swam till I grew very sick. And when I came out, she examined my gold watch and chain, which I left in her care. The face was all broken, no fingers were there. She took me to her house, which had trees in the front. She took me upstairs and she showed me a Union Jack, which is red, white and blue. I saw something else, but I'm not telling you.
Well, right.
She took me upstairs.
She took
me upstairs and I examined her Union Jack.
I examined.
That's the difference between you and him, sir. I'm that's right. Well, have a look at it, haven't you? I say to them in Italy, I see we've got Grand Wattle, just like a cock. One of them
red-haired Rhode Island. What was that one you used to sing me? In the bottom of a punt.
Oh yeah. Once while sailing in a punt, I sipped and kissed a guinea punt. Like girls in Forest or Lady Gus, they think it's simply great. Where's something like that, did he go?
Yeah.
But getting back to singing.
this one might have come yet. Yes. Carry on, it might have come yet.
Right.
The Maoris were fine singers.
Oh yeah, I heard a bit.
Now they used to, at the start of the camp where I was, after dark, they'd just strike up, and of course they got the instruments too, you know, the guitars. And that was the first time I ever heard that the Maori's farewell, which later Gracie Fields sang, and she didn't call it. What did she call it? She didn't call it farewell.
Now is the hour.
Now is the hour. But it was the Maori's farewell.
Mm-hmm. Oh, they made that into a waltz, didn't they?
No, that's right.
That was a Maori song originally.
The Maori's farewell. That was a Maori song. That was. Native of New Zealand.
Do you know what happened to them once? The South Africans got together and they made shields out of cardboard, and all the shields put together formed the map of Africa.
Mm-hmm.
And they sang, they dressed as Zulus, all blacked themselves over.
Well, I remember.
You remember?
Yeah, I remember.
Dressed
yeah.
as Zulus, and mm-hmm. one came out in the middle, did the chanting, you know, the Zulus. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
He sang, Yeolele Mama. And then all the rest took up the chorus. And what it was asking Mama's permission to marry the daughter.
Mm-hmm.
And it went somewhere like this, Yeolele Mama, Mama. And then the others would sing that.
Chanting.
And then he'd sing, what was on set? See your tail and your caricone, mama. See your lady, mama. And it sounded most impressive.
I remember.
And they were waving the. Mm. You know, doing the Zulu.
Was this black South Africans?
No, white South Africans. White South Africans.
Well, they were civilised in those days, weren't they?
Oh,
did you ever see the Maoris do this war chanting?
I never come across the Maoris.
They
weren't in our camp.
Well, in the camp where I was, they used to have these shows, and
we had New Zealanders.
They did this,
but not Maoris.
War chanting, you know. fair, but the window pane. We may have had.
Yeah, bloke told
where
me.
They warmed up, you know, to go in the bathroom.
Yeah, bloke told me.
The Schleter in Middlewich told me that he saw them do that and then go into the hospital with bayonets, where they'd heard the Germans were bayoneting the Maori injured. And he said it's the most frightening bloody thing he's ever seen in his life.
Concrete. Whatever it was, you know, they were singing and warming up and that.
Yes, it was on Crete, in Crete, Dad.
What was
were you there?
I was in Crete.
At that particular issue?
Don't ask me if I can repeat the
words. What was that one of you used to sing?
But did you see that?
You was in Crete.
When we were in
Crete. So you'd have mentioned come to Crete. You'd have mentioned you'd come to Crete.
Ah, so on.
Saloniki, was he in Thessaloniki? I was in that guy.
Something McCaffrey.
Well, I once went working on a working party at Salonika, down to the docks. And there was a Greek girl there.
I shed his blood. That's how it went, didn't it?
What Liverpool assizes, oh my Christ, the judge and jury said unto me, prepare thyself, oh McCaffrey.
That was how it went.
I had no father.
I had no father to take my part. It was that. Liverpool loved you singing, wasn't it?
Well, that little song, This Is My Story, This Is My
this
Story.
This is my story, this is my story.
I've been in the army too bloody long.
I've been in prison too bloody long.
Well, the army, aren't
So you Roland and Nelson, the Rodney the Hood.
This
bleeding life is no good.
This bloody life is no good.
It's of course the old hymn tune, isn't it? This is my song. I've been in this island too bleeding long. Roland and Nelson, the Rodney the Hood. For this looking island, there's no fucking good.
is that all there is to it?
Hmm?
There's
more to it.
There's more to it.
About Frey Marie, do you remember that one? It's a First World War song about the brothel down in Belgium.
No, I don't know that.
Way down in Frey Marie, 10 francs I paid to see a French tattooed lady, tattooed from head to knee. On her left jaw was the Royal Flying Corps, and on her back was the Union Jack. Could anyone ask for me?
What, you say that, they always used to say that?
Yeah.
If you asked them for bread. Barney de Marni.
De Marni, but deal. You say, sempre mangia.
Now, what was that song that you were, that one that you were singing when we ran out? Are we all right, Thomas?
We're off for the CRE.
Yes. What about the barge?
How does it start?
Wasn't the barge in the middle of the river?
You were fast, didn't
you? Well, I don't know whether we're talking about a different one now.
When you were all singing together, then?
They say there's a boat on the river, they say that it's loaded with beer. Oh, why is that boat on the river, they poking well ought to be here. Singing, I jiggy-jig, fuck a little big, follow the band all the way. Singing, I jiggy-jig, fuck a little pig, follow the band all the way. I've been in the saddle for hours and hours, I stuck it as long as I could. I stuck it, and then I said, fuck it, my arsehole is not made of wood. Follow the band all the way. Follow the band all the way. I rise at 10:30 each morning.
What's that?
Sing one.
Yeah.
Oi, it's gone. Anyway, it's the same song, another verse. It ends up pressed through the hole in the wall.
Was it Mr. Carney on you the rest of that,
didn't he? No. Oh, I sung another version this morning.
What was that? What is that, the barge? They say there's a barge on the river.
Yeah.
Well, you go on that one, Nick. Nick, we'll put Nick on.
They say there's a barge on the river. They say it's all loaded with beer. They say there's a barge on the river. God blimey, I wish it was here. For I'll ever drop, you'll ever drop, we'll ever drop too. Down at the hole in the wall. I'll ever drop, you'll ever drop, we'll ever drop too. Down at the hole in the wall.
That sounds like the expurgated version.
Yeah, it does. Hole in the wall. The hole in the wall has got to go for something like this.
Yeah.
Are we going on our list?
What about the gay caballero?
Oh, come on, Ben. Yes, the gay caballero.
Oh, right.
Oh, yes. That's a Frank one. Frank.
No, that's
Ben. Can't Ben give us a bit of his guitar?
Yes.
He hasn't done much of it.
He just
Well, how about the wine guitar?
You know.
Do you know a song to go there?
No. It's you can only accompany others, you see.
More or less, I do it like, you know, like this. what's that one earlier? This Western stuff, you know. What's the one?
The wheel
of the wagon is broken. It ain't gonna turn no more. The old grey mare is dead and gone. The Swedes round the ranch house door. Ding, ding, ding. I've got my guns and my saddle, and I ain't going to ride no more. My spurs and go, my guns and my saddle, but I'm wearing city clothes. There ain't no campfires smoking where we sang when the day it was through. The wheel of the wagon is broken and the days of the West are through. Boom, 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 boom. So goodbye, old timer. Goodbye to the friends that I knew. Goodbye, old faithful. The days of the West are through. Ding, 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 ding.
Ah, and the flat there, the string broke. The gay caballero then, Ben.
Right. Now there once was a gay caballero who strolled through the streets of Palmero, flashing the whole of his wonderful, wonderful toodle-a-yoodle-a-gay. Now he met a gay senorita, an exceedingly gay senorita, and he showed her the whole of his wonderful, wonderful toodle-a-yoodle-a-gay. So she took him to her hacienda, an exceedingly large hacienda, and she played with the whole of his wonderful, wonderful toodle-a-yoodle-a-gay. So they lay down upon the sofito, an exceedingly springy sofito, and he put in the end of his wonderful, wonderful toodle-a-yoodle-a-gay. Now he's got a dose of clapito, an exceeding large dose of clapito, right on the end of his wonderful, wonderful toodle-a-yoodle-a-gay.
And so he went to see Urciano, an exceedingly great Urciano, who cut off the end of his wonderful, wonderful
Turalaya.
Now this bold and this brave cavaliero still strolls through the streets of Palmiro, flashing what's left of his wonderful, wonderful
Turalaya.
Great stuff. Does anybody know Charlotte the Harlot?
Oh, who was it? Who's the Charlotte the Harlot?
Mr. Carnell.
That was Mr. Carnell's ditty, wasn't it?
Charlotte the Harlot.
He described that as playground. Playground songs in London. Go on.
I was 10 years old when I first
heard this. Oh, yeah, it's cool to like in London.
What was the song you used to sing to the Commandant?
Oh, yeah, we wanted to ask you about that, Bill. What was the song? Was it Silver Threads Among the Gold?
Oh, yeah, Silver Threads Among the Gold. Mm.
How did that go?
Growing
older. Mm. Oh, well,
that's very old.
That's a mucky version of that. We've got Darling, can you put my hand 1 inch above the knee?
Yeah.
Do you know that one?
Darling, let me tie your guard.
Darling, let me tie your guard. Just 1 inch above the knee. If my answer is wonder, Father, please don't think it rude of me.
Yeah. You didn't sing that version.
Didn't sing that.
But that's the only part that's going. I mean, I don't think there's any more verses to that, is there?
I don't know.
No, just that.
Never
just
heard one.
Well, that's what he wanted to learn. He said, I don't know why I wanted to learn that bloody song, because he had me and old Jock Attrill singing that every day.
Silver threads among the gold. Oh, I am growing old.
That's that one. But just that bit. Remember
that one, that one was out. The band of young soldiers was camping out, talking to sweetheart, saying you.
Who was that?
That one about the band of young soldiers were camping out, talking to sweetheart, saying you. They all were quite glad accepting what he had.
Oh, even then, I didn't want to know that. Mom and Dad. She was poor, but she was honest.
Go on, Frank. What was that? Do you know the tune of this one? No. A band of young soldiers once campaigned.
Yes. When the Greek prisoners arrived. So, when the Greek prisoners arrived. They all were quite glad accepting one lad, and even then, I
didn't. And he was downhearted and sad.
You know that one?
I know the verse to it, the chorus to it.
Well, how's the chorus go?
His comrade, they said.
One is there of silvery gold.
Oh, that one, yeah.
The other is air of silvery hue, the other is air of gold. One is young and beautiful, the other one is bent and old.
One is my mother.
Both of their lives are endeared to me, never again shall we part. One is my mother, God bless her, the other is my sweetheart.
Can you remember the tune of that one?
Yeah, that's the same tune as well.
One has air of silvery grey, the other is air like gold. Both of their lives are endeared to me, never again we'll part. One is my mother, God bless her, I love her, and the other is my sweetheart.
Can you remember the verse? Is the verse?
I don't know the verse, that's all.
Was that the one that Frank is singing?
I think it is.
It starts up.
The chorus.
Then the young soldiers once campaigned out.
Have any of you heard the red caboose? That red caboose behind the train. You ever heard
that's
that?
A Yankee thing, isn't it?
Yeah, it isn't really. It has been some time too.
What was the other
one?
That
little red caboose behind the train.
I know that one, but.
What was that mean? It's a rose of no man's land.
Aye, that was the one.
There's a rose that grows in no man's land. And it's wonderful to see. Though it's shed with tears, it will live for years. in my garden of memories. There is one red rose, a soldier knows, it's the work of a mighty hand. Through the war's great years, fell the Red Cross nurse. She's a rose of no man's land.
Did you get the village virgin there, all right?
No, no, we didn't. Let's have that one. We've got bugger all on Thursdays, Frank.
But it was in PG. Thought of that, or you'd string that in prison camp.
Holy God.
That one? Aye. We used to, Scotland always used to sing that.
Was that the whole of it?
Yeah, when was that?
We could do that.
And he used to sing another one about silver eyed mother, there is no other, can be such a part to me. That was another one he used to sing. Sunshine or rain.
You must remember, we used to get very sentimental.
I found this little rose of no man's land and it's on the back of a bloody photograph of the day.
Don't get any details about that photograph, Frank.
Well, I have a photograph, it's only Gladys, I mean. I was missing.
It's a photograph.
Yes. Yeah, great. Yeah,
we're getting some chips.
Are you?
Yes. Are you fit?
Come on, Frank, tell the whole story about that photograph.
Yes, the village village.
Oh, yes, sir.
Oh, well, it's rather long, but it's, I know it. Well, I used to sing, I sang it very often.
Yes. I didn't order as many as we
had. I sang it at the very end, didn't I?
How many did you have?
It's not too bad. It can be.
He'll be all right. Alan, if he has to.
I don't know whether
it's going to be saved for the next audience.
Yeah.
Say that's all right.
Too much trouble because we just Thomas suggested.
If he has, I'm going to say, when they arrived, you couldn't have very well missed it.
The village virgin, yes.
Now
in the town of West Virginia, there's a girl called Nancy Brown. She's the sweetest in any city. She's the fairest in any town, and her face it isn't painted, and her breath it isn't tainted. She's as pure as the West Virginia sky.
Yeah, I'm all right.
So came the village deacon, with his voice so low and kind, took Nancy up the mountain, but when she read his mind, she came rolling down the mountain. She came rolling down the mountain. She came rolling down the mountain, oh so wise. And this dirty old village deacon didn't get what he went seeking. She's as pure as the West Virginia skies. Then came Anderson the trapper with a story of his deeds. He took Nancy up the mountain, but when she knew his needs, she came rolling down the mountain. She came rolling down the mountain. She came rolling down the mountain, oh so wise. And before, as I have stated, she was uncontaminated. She's as pure as the West Virginia skies. So then came the village cowboy, the cowboy with his song. He took Nancy up the mountain, but she's still no right from wrong. She came rolling down the mountain. She came rolling down the mountain. She came rolling down the mountain, oh so wise. And despite this cowboy's urging, she remains the village virgin. She's as pure as the West Virginia sky. But came the city slicker with his $1 million bill. He put Nancy in his placard and he rode her up that hill. And they stayed there in the mountain, yeah, they stayed there in the mountain. Stayed there in the mountain all that night. She came down next morning early, more a woman than a girlie, and her daddy kicked his daughter from his sight. Now the ending to my ditty is she's living in the city, and by all accounts she's doing mighty swell. Between her whining and her dining, she's on her couch reclining, and the West Virginia skies can go to hell. Now that an American heard me sing this, and he gave me another version of another verse, and it goes like this. Now along came old man Depression. Kick set his slicker in the pants. He lost all his money, so he's all washed up with Nance. So she went back to the mountain, yeah, she went back to the mountain. She went back to the mountain mighty poor. She and the cowboy and the deacon, now get what they go seeking. She is known now as the West Virginia whore.
What about Vicina La Morte?
What?
Vicina La Morte. La
Morte. Vicina La Morte.
Yes,
that's near the mountain, isn't it?
Yes.
That's Giovanni's.
Giovanni's song. Yes, you can't remember any more of it, Bill.
Well, that's all he used to sing.
That's all he got from us.
That's all he used to sing. Day, all day, won't he, Frank?
Yeah.
Drummed through your bloody ears, and that's how we got to know each other. Because he was singing it all day. It was only two or three lines, and repeating himself over and over.
Was this an Italian to do it?
Italian, yeah.
Ah, one of the guys.
Hmm?
No, where they were escaping.
Where we were escaping.
Hmm. You can't remember the tune of it, because the tune doesn't come over very clear on the...
The tune of it is... Yes. The tune was... Virginia Monte, Virginia Monte, tra la 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 la, tra la 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 la. Veni, 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 qua, 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 tanti baci china, tanti baci china, tanti baci china. Virginia Monte, Virginia Monte, tra la 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 la, tra la 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 la. That's all he sang, wasn't it, Frank?
Yeah, four bloody ones of it.
Kept repeating himself all the time.
Yeah, right. What about, Red, there was a whole list of ones you mentioned. There was one German one. Yeah. Seyes Man Einbruch.
Seyes Man Einbruch.
How did that go?
Well, I was hoping to... remember a bit more of it, but the Germans always used to sing as they marched, and it sounded like...
Very good too, weren't it? Singing on the march, I was telling
they had to be, or why they got thumped by the corporal.
Yeah,
they were ordered to sing.
Mm. It was part of the drill, wasn't it?
Mm. And
very good.
We used to, you know, the guard used to say, come on, sing, and if we refused to, they used to strike up their own song. And that was one of them, but I'm sorry, I can't remember any more than...
And what you call it? What is it
in German? We used to add our own words, you know, six man Einbruch. Well, Brock
six
was
man
a two-pound loaf, and they used to give us one loaf between six men.
And what were your words?
Well, six man Einbruch, that is to feel mein Gott. And they go, younger, 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 something like that, anyway. But it's German, we used to tough our own words in, and write up the empty word.
Double stage, English middle.
We've got these versions of Fred
Carno's
Army.
But can I just pursue this one? You can't remember. I mean, it's your words to it that we're interested in. Right. Can you remember yours?
Or
how the tune went?
All highly scurrilous and obscene. And we used to make them up as we went along.
Yeah.
So you could virtually compose one yourself on the spot, as it were, because that's what we were doing anyway.
Yeah.
They were ordinary German marching songs, army marching songs, and we used to took our own words then.
Uh-huh.
So one, I don't think there'd be any use to you. We were never allowed to sing National Anthem in Germany.
No.
But they couldn't make head or tail of why we always used to sing Land of Hope and Glory.
Mm-hmm.
And whenever we were really feeling really sarcastic or wanted to put one over on, we used to sing Land of Hope and Glory, not in the middle of a railway station when we'd been ferried back to camp or something.
Yeah.
And the guards sort of caught on to the wider still and wider. They used to say, fighter still and fighter. You know, for carry on working but further on. And they used to pick up things like that, and so we sang it in our own German version of Land of Hope and Glory. We weren't expert linguists, so we used to compose as we went along in German. So if I went home and sat down and thought about it, I could think about the German version of Land of Hope and Glory. I'm sorry, I can't help you at the moment.
He used to sing, what's it, Wunschmann Glück,
You see, I never went out.
You'd eventually
come up to the Germany,
would you, from Italy? No, well, I was in the Swiss part of, when we got to Switzerland, we were in the German-speaking part of Switzerland.
Did you get to Switzerland?
Oh, yeah. We got
Switzerland. Yeah.
But Switzerland doesn't go a language.
No, they speak French on one side, they speak German, don't they?
Well, where we were, was German, you see.
Yes.
And they used to sing this. Wünsch mir Glück. That was wish me bloody
luck. Wish me luck.
As we wish me good luck.
Wishing Glück.
Wünsch mir Glück.
Yeah. Mm.
What else have we got here?
I had Easter card. I had it from Austria this last Easter.
You see, as that girl says to me when I went from the, when I was from there, she says, well, she wrote me a letter. Good job my wife could read it. And, said, meinem Schatzi.
Meinem Schatz.
Meinem Schatz, yeah. Started off. Ich habe mich. Oh, ich habe mich. Ein Tochterbischen. Und ich weiß nicht, oder du ein Kind nicht hättest.
I've learnt one or two of the German songs.
That is
it.
She didn't know
the what?
And she didn't know whether she was in
charge. Heute Volunteer ein Liedland singen. And they were all German marching songs. That one, of course, is highly unlikely because it's a bit faring gig in England.
What did they call, Doctor?
Top.
Can you remember that? Oh, you were telling me about that one. That, Reg. Can you sing that one? And Daughter is also...
The faring gig in England.
Your version of that, yeah.
Daughter is
Brother is Bruder. It's a straight version.
Yeah.
Heute wollen wir ein Liedlein singen, trinken wollen wir den coolen Wein. Und die Gläser sollen dazu klingen, für es muss geschehen sein. Gib's mir deine Hand. Deine weiße Hand, lieb wohl mein Schatz, lieb wohl mein Schatz, lieb wohl, liebe wohle. Denn wir fahren gegen England, dort heute.
That's when you're coming to England. You see, this bloke from Middlewich was telling me that they had their own version of that about gegen Deutschland.
Yeah, well, I learnt the German version, and of course they added their own words after it.
Yeah,
you can virtually do from scratch anyway.
I've got the
least possible bit of composing.
Yeah, I've got an English version of that one from this bloke from Middlewich, which they talked about. Because the English used to walk, used to walk along singing this, and everybody was thinking how ridiculous until they sang Gegen Deutschland at the end of it.
I was just singing that one, we go down and get the washing on the ZP line, all that stuff in us.
How are we doing?
We're nearly finished, actually. What was Pompey's song?
Oh, yes. The one that he more or less put the music to during the Depression. Now, in a minute. I've got that somewhere. I put it down so that I could remember it, because my memory isn't what it used to be, I'm afraid. I don't know where the hell I put it, neither. Oh, wait, here we are. You want me to rhyme it off?
Yes, absolutely.
It went like this. It's a long way no longer, it's a long way no more. I can see the turning in the lane, I can hear that grand refrain. Rule Britannia, it rings from shore to shore. Never, never fear, victory is near, it's a long way no more. Just the one bit, you know, that he put music. That was in the height of the depth, you may say, of depression in the camp.
Who was Pompey?
Pompey was actually TSM or PSM, that is Patrol Sergeant Major,
Ireland, who was our band leader and band master.
Oh, I see. Oh, yeah, that's right.
Did the photograph, Bill? Hmm? Did the photograph?
You remember him?
I remember all of them.
Sticky glue and coke.
That sounds like. What about McCaffery, though? We were about to do McCaffery.
Well, we got distracted from McCaffery. Oh, here's Alan with some chicks.
Bring it in, Jim. He's on a real part of the tune of that.
Yeah? How does it go, McCaffery? Your tune.
Well, you see, I can't start from the beginning. This is the part as I know.
Do you know this one, Ben McCaffery?
I didn't
know. No, I'm on the first few lines.
Just you sing your tune.
The tune is, for me, it's verse 7.
Yeah.
I did the deed, I shed the blood. At Liverpool Assizes, my trial I stood. The judge, he said, McCaffery, prepare yourself for the gallows tree.
It was it's more or less like it's not like a song, it's more or less
like a monogram.
Or a monologue. Musical monologue.
Yeah. I had no father to take my part. I had no mother to break her heart.
Excuse the paper.
I had one friend, a girl with teeth. And she laid down her life for McCaffery.
Thank you.
Leave it.
Let's have a pause. Have a pause
there.
Yes.
I'm long now. Oh, you can see my powers are restricted a little.
What was that with, Ben?
Well, I had a tumour.
Yeah.
And so I have it out.
Yeah.
Tumour and ulcerated.
Mm.
Was that due to the war?
I never could prove anything. You can't. Yeah. I mean, I couldn't go and say that, of course, through my prisoner of war life or anything.
They could
have said, well, it could go normally, you know, a normal man. I couldn't do anything about it at all.
I wouldn't help it.
Have you smoked first?
No, I shouldn't think it would help it, would it?
No.
No, it didn't help it. Oh, no.
There are three here. I couldn't. You've done them by the time I got.
No, I've done 32 years of my service, and I don't get any.
Yeah, stick them in
here. How long?
Where's what it called? Come
here. Ah, Jeff. It's all territorial mostly.
Yeah.
Of a dark cell battery here.
Yeah,
it's really
nice.
Yeah. Lovely, isn't it?
Mm. Garrison battery. Garrison artillery, I joined in 1922.
How's it come and get rashes from me?
51st Medal of Medium?
Yes.
When you were Sergeant Major then?
Oh, not at first. No, I was a Sergeant Major after the war.
Yeah.
Oh, during the war, rather.
What were you in 1939?
In 1939, I was a sergeant then, because I'd reverted back. I was a quartermaster sergeant in 1937.
Oh, what?
I was on the King's coronation.
You never go.
What were you doing in the King's coronation? Sort of
standing still. All day, 11 and a quarter hours.
Where?
Opposite St. James's Palace.
And you had to stand there for how long?
11 and a quarter hours. It was not so tedious as you thought.
Yeah.
I mean, there's young women around on one thing or another, and you could lay your rifle down and go up for a quick jimmy. And of course, you could then sneak up and have a cup of tea like somewhere.
So I am some.
And then.
Theoretically, you were meant to stand there for that amount of time. Theoretically, you're meant to
stand
there
for that
amount.
Oh, yes. My Aunt Lou was in the procession, walked 14 and a quarter miles, and had to go at night to see the picture of the parade.
I'll put him in the oven now.
Because all he saw was the man's back in front of him.
Well,
I saw the lot. The gorgeous robes of the Sikhs and the Indian princes and all that, you know.
You were a regular soldier, weren't you?
No, I was a TA.
Were you with them when they got horses?
That stopped me from being right.
Really?
You
did that before the war?
No. Yes, I did that before I was 16.
Really?
And I was in the Arnitt battery then.
Were you with them?
How do you do that?
Were you with them when they got horses? And eight horses are gone.
I was. I used to ride horse holder for Major Brook. I'm going to get the stuff back. And all the rest of the people.
I used to come down and watch him, man.
I used to ride with Major.
I'm doing the book of
Lieutenant Wood. If Nick gives you. We won the Scarborough Trophy.
Wood? Captain Wood.
Yeah, Captain Wood was after.
I don't trust you.
Ben Ford is my uncle.
How did you lads come home then? End of February.
Yeah,
when the clubs were closing up, not permitted in that
time. And position.
And of course, he never come so as
he was outdated.
He sent a letter to the person we rided in an old mill.
We came out 3 weeks after Dunkirk.
From this part. They just ducked out of it. He never said nothing to nobody. Just a nudge. And off. We had one guy, he was a waiter in London before the war, right? And he was also a prisoner of war in the First World War.
Makes you mad,
he talked fluent English. And he got a very bad leg, you see, and so he said, we should have a middle MBE, you know, rest of it. And when we were sitting down, he just looked out of it because it was all massive size. He took him away, you see. And we went and we shed in an old mill. On a farm that my father worked for.
That's a few weeks.
Of course, we stopped there.
Why?
And then one day, they had some evacuees from a place called Gratz.
An Ontario.
And he missed the usual train that he came on, and he had to get the last train when he walked from Lanark, a place called Lanark.
I also passed out to this
farmhouse. And of course, we used to go around and get potatoes and stuff like that, and maize meal, and start cooking it up at night time in the cold, you know, put all the blankets up to the
top. Sergeant Major on recommendation.
And there was a path within, say, 8 yards
of Royal Horse Artillery.
Of this mill. That he used to go past. And he ate the pots and pans
battle.
And so, of course, he went to this. As he went home, he went to the equipment and said, there's something going on in the old mill.
And little party, you know, gets
really
straight away.
You can't always get, though. I haven't been able to get because of
this
my work.
Person that was a neighbour of this farm.
I used to work 7 days a week.
They had the name on the end, and he said, Alan and Robinson.
On Saturday,
but anyway, we said we'd have to get away from there. So he
was going, when you have a drink, you can't drive over.
To another place. We supplied us with a machine gun and a rifle.
I was on lubrication and
this
engineering.
Badly sand
chattering.
And he says, well, four of us, you see, this hotel, because we don't have to keep in two for months on end. Out of food barrels. But this cheeky company
should have been part-time job.
Every night. To our local, which was like a farmhouse, one big room in a farmhouse, 22 of us. And he's coming up on the window, saying, have you got any cots here? You know, at the farmhouse.
I think you might agree.
Move to the farm and take him a couple of tins out.
I can't stagnate anyway.
And eventually we went to this mill, and they were riding.
Because before the war, I'd never had a easy job.
Four of us.
Worked in a stone quarry.
Anyway, this
grass,
this chap was evacuated out of.
And they had these pots and pans
wrapped around me in the cooking. So therefore, they didn't look at it, so we had to say, right, we'll have to get out of it. So we went to this parts envelope and they said, right, well, two of you can stop here and two of you can go to a chap by the name of Blettery. We'd never, and my friend and myself were elected to go to this chap, you see. So they said, go to this farmhouse. There's four windows down the side, one of the lid, that'd be his kitchen, you might say.
Excuse me.
And knock, give the victory sign on the window. Boom, 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 you know. And the pile of stones here, duck behind this pile of stones. They come out here. Well, we've never seen this before. I've never seen this before. You're just a peasant farmer. Now he comes along and he just says, oh, you're the under. You want to stay for the other half, right? So he took us in there and he's bar.
in a room that was what he used to keep all his empty barrels. And he fixed us up there, and we sat there until we walked in. We used to come out at night time, you know, just for a rough fresh air, really different places.
We travelled France, didn't we, France, in cattle trucks from Switzerland.
Did you?
Went back to Bloody. Went back to Bloody. Marseilles, come to Marseilles, join the American army.
Yeah.
In the American army, they slapped and bloody peaches and everything all together in one bloody pan.
And they?
And then they put us on a ship and we thought we were in America and we ended up back in bloody Italy, didn't we?
Yeah.
They were bloody Staffordshire. Then came on one inch by Staffordshire.
Ah.
The bloody gunny officer was a bloke and he used to be the full of surveyor's officer.
And
yeah, we slung all his bloody stuff on the bloody side because he thought we'd only got so much to land with.
Mm. Ben, what about that pop punk song?
Oh, well, I don't really know it, to be truthful. I don't really know it. I think...
What's that one?
You know, she hung herself.
That's what we haven't got.
The father come and cut her down.
Oh.
Right, sister,
isn't it? My sister, she sang it as a girl. She wouldn't know it now,
would she? How did it start then?
I wish my baby had a little bit of a
Remember that very soggy, sentimental thing? How he used to buy Ireland.
Frank used to write by Ireland.
Highest bloody Irish. You
read me a passage out of
Ireland. I never did, no.
Don't it reformed me.
Spell that was mother. I miss the many things she gave me.
It's a prize, ain't it?
Baby good as daddy.
Eh? I say, it's a prize, ain't it? Bumping the chaps. Now, when he was thumping us in Greece at this time, down at a place called Cal Martin, and, it was like a sort of a Dunkirk act. He was pushing you down there, and we used to go down to the beaches at night time, though, you see. And we're all lined up there waiting for these boats, supposedly, to come in. And I was driving along for this blog, and I just happened to say, like, I just happened to say, there's another guy lined up alongside him, and he said, here you have, mate, try that. Impossible English. Anyway, he gives me this water bottle and I have a good swill of it.
Ici la Suisse. Hey, au dernier top, il sera exactement...
Oh, well, you know, get it, damn it. Mm-hmm. And he comes from Nelson Street, Fenton. Oh, you're kicking the arse sort of thing from me.
Vous êtes à l'écoute d'une émission de la radiodiffusion suisse destinée à nos auditeurs en Afrique dans les bandes des
19-20. Is it Bill
who knows it? Eric knew most of it, I think.
Oh.
Eric, he was the one that knew most of it, wasn't he? Wasn't he, you remember?
Well, he's looking there. Do you want to try and
find
this?
Yes, sir. Talisman?
Yeah.
I've just finished it.
Have you?
Yeah.
What do you think about it? It's not bad.
It's not bad.
What do you suppose?
This is,
then all my troubles, they'd have gone.
Now, it doesn't start like that, does it? Starts off. An old man coming home from work one night. He found his house without a light. He went upstairs to get in bed when queer thoughts came in his head. Into his daughter's room he went and found her hanging from a beam. And he took a knife to cut her down. And on her dress these words he found. My lover was a sailor boy who sailed across the deep blue sea.
I forgot it after that, what did he, Frank?
Doing pretty well up to there.
Off the road after that. It misses you, and all of that, and then it goes. I wish my baby had been born. Then all my troubles they'd have gone. So dig my grave and dig it deep, and lay white lilies at my feet. They dug a grave and dug it deep, and laid white lilies at her feet. And on her breast they placed a dove, to signify she died for love. Now all you maidens bear in mind, a soldier's heart is hard to find. But should you find one good and true, ne'er change the old love for the new.
That's nearly all of it. You say it's Tug that knows the main.
I think Tug knows
the majority of it, indeed.
That's most of it anyway.
That's nearly
Bruno, all of it. By the way.
That's most of it.
Now, Ben, have you got any more on your list?
Oh, I've got songs, yes.
Come on, let's hear.
Where the heck have we put that boot?
Put them on the nose to you.
You're on.
It was by the sea of St. Gasso I wandered one night. The moonbeams were shining so clear. For no reason at all, I heard someone call for Abdul the Bulbul the Mere. Now Abdul the Bulbul I knew to be dead. His story had spread near and far. How he lost his life while plunging his knife into Ivan Stravinsky's cabal. It was just at that moment the moonbeams descended quite low, banishing all shadows, and then I opened my eyes and to my surprise found I was by the graves of these two famous men. Now from the two shadows arose from the grave the form of a Russian hussar. My skin nearly peeled as he stood there revealed it was Ivan Stravinsky's cabal. It was he who'd been calling my skin nearly peeled, my heart it was beating through fear. When out of the grave, in need of a shave, stepped Abdul the Bulbul the Mere. Would speak to me, Ivan, quoth Abdul, then I would, replied Ivan quite clear. That quarrel we had was all to the bad, friend Abdul the Bulbul the Mere. Thou blameless, so Ivan, cried Abdul again, the fault was entirely mine own. But Ivan said, nay, it was never that way, the fault lay in my hands alone. Wouldst call me a coward, quoth Abdul again, take heed or I'll slice off thine ear. You son of a cat, you could never do that, O Abdul the Bulbul the Mere. So once more they quarrelled and fought as before, while the multitude came from afar and applauded with cheers the bold buccaneers, this Turk and this Russian hussar. The ghost of the Tsar on a fiery black steed came prancing to witness the fray. And the Sultan was there in a big jewel chair. It was just like a scene from the play. It was just at that moment each knife found its mark, and I heard a blood-curdling scream. And I opened my eyes, and to my surprise I found out it was only a dream.
Hey, that's lovely.
Good,
yes, right.
A minute.
Right.
When this bloody war is over, oh, how happy I will be.
When will tell the sun
no. Goes.
In a minute, let's have a bit of a thing.
Where we'll kiss or something.
No, no. Here we go. Right.
When this bloody war is over, oh, how happy I will be. When this bloody war is over, no more soldiering for me. No more church parades on Sunday. No more asking for a pass. We will tell the sergeant major to take his passes up his ass.